signals the achievement of the interdepartmental task team and I'm still in some respects. This still remains a challenge, and I think I'll come back to that when we talk about how we think that manufacturing is positioned so as we move forward. But I think that we do need to highlight the new measures that have been proposed on the export of scrap metal. That process, I believe, is still out for public consultation, but we think that the new measures will be able to ensure that the resource above the ground, as I've heard it described, actually becomes an input into local manufacturing rather than being exported as it is at the moment. The vast bulk of it exported even to countries that don't allow their own scrap metal to be exported. So I think that is one intervention that has emerged on the iron and steel task team. Another was that the IDC is actively seeking to find promote competition in the steel sector, involving bringing in new foreign investors to become involved in particularly the production of steel products based on what's called MIFELT iron ore deposits. There's the amendment to the Competition Act, which is still underway, to ensure that the use of market dominance and supply of strategic inputs into manufacturing is curtailed. Then if I come to sector-specific programs, the automotive's medium and heavy commercial sector, a major advance in this regard has been the finalization of the transition from the Motor Industry Development Program to the Automotive Production and Development Program, which took effect at the beginning of this year. As I think you all know, there was one part of the ABEP, which is the Automotive Investment Scheme, which we fast-tracked and brought forward, which had a significant impact on ensuring automotive investments. But also our work with the transition from the APDP has involved bringing into the program medium and heavy commercial vehicle segments. What we've done over the last few years is we've ensured private sector investments worth approximately 16 billion rand, including investments in public transport vehicles. Some of the new investments, which we've not had before, include the first automotive works truck plant in Kuka, the Beijing automotive works taxi assembly plant, Toyota's taxi assembly line and distribution center, and then we've also had important investments in Mercedes-Benz new C-Class production, BMW's increased productive capacity in Rosslyn, and all in all, production in the automotive sector is now up to over 500,000 vehicles, 539,424 units, with exports of 277,893 units. The strengthening of the local component sector, which has been a major objective, has been bolstered by the Automotive Investment Scheme, and that this has supported 128 projects in component manufacturing, sustaining 57,197 jobs. In clothing, textiles, and leather footwear, I mentioned here that we've seen something of a stabilization of the sector, which was in terminal decline in the years before we introduced the new competitiveness program. The competitiveness program seems to have had a positive effect. It's halted the employment decline, and in fact, 12,205 new permanent jobs have been created in this sector. We've seen, I think, one of the things that I would highlight as a positive feature of private sector commitment to localization is we've seen some local retailers committing themselves to long-term local procurement arrangements with manufacturers. I want to highlight here a company like Fushimi, which is participating in a cluster program and which is supporting CMT operations such as that by Prestige Clothing. Over 469 companies have been assisted with the competitiveness program for the global textile sector, with 1.5 million worth of applications approved. I might add here as well that we've also seen some welcome turnaround in the fortunes of the footwear and leather industry, which actually is now talking quite bullishly about the prospects for that sector in South Africa. The last year's IPAP signaled a focus on sectors where we thought significant domestic capacity opportunities exist, and these include metals, capital equipment, and transport equipment sector, agro-processing, green industries, pharmaceuticals, and business process services. And highlights of this include, we were instrumental in securing the 1 billion rand investment in the metals coating facility, Sapphire Steel, investments of 1.2 billion to assist various previously disadvantaged people and SMEs in the agro-processing sector. And I think the agro-processing sector will see this as some very significant investments by multinationals. They include Unilever, Nestle, among others. The Agro-Competitiveness Investment Fund approved projects that value $76 million. There is a new 150 million soybean facility which was supported under the Manufacturing Investment Program, and other investments facilitated in various subsectors such as rooibos, honeybush, small scale milling, and food processing. I should mention that the agreement has been reached by the Department of Industry on the design of a fiscal incentive for the biofuels industry. And this, we believe, will enable the pilot projects to take off, but there are also many, many other opportunities. We think that the benefits of this should be that we could save up to 9 billion rand on the balance of payments. We could create up to 55,000 jobs and reduce by 498,000 tons per annum CO2 equivalent emissions. We launched, it was last week, the new Aquaculture Development and Enhancement Program. We've seen a few aquaculture projects take off, but I was actually shocked to make a check the figure. We only produce 1% of the African continent's aquaculture. We are very far behind countries like Egypt and even Nigeria. There are huge opportunities for aquaculture, both in marine fish products as well as inland fish products. And we've had the rollout of the renewable energy program. This has underpinned significant investments in the sector. They include, for example, a 300 million rand investment by DCD, a 4.6 billion investment by Mainstream Renewable Power, and a 2.6 billion investment by Sun Edison. The business processing sector, the change of the incentive which we brought about there, was one based on capital expenditure to one based on operation expenditure. That's made our program extremely competitive. And we saw there was a 1.1 billion investment was leveraged through the scheme, creating 4,500 jobs, the vast majority of whom are young people under 35 years of age. Sustained support through the film incentive has facilitated an impressive roster of locally shot blockbuster films. We've got a wide variety of films that have been shot in this country, I think that we have quadrupled the number of films that have been shot in this country over the last 5 years. Now, let me then, on the basis of those achievements, say where do we think that industrial policy needs to go in the future? Well, we think that there are bits of work that are identified in the current IPAP, which we believe will lay an important foundation for new phases of industrial development in the years ahead. And the first of these is in the area of minerals beneficiation. Now, we've long talked about this minerals beneficiation as something which we need to achieve. And And I think myself that we need to identify minerals beneficiation in two senses. First of all, it is important that we add more value to mineral products before we export them, even if we don't use those mineral products in any manufacturing processes in South Africa. And I'll give just one example. There's a project which has been supported by the NEF and the IEC, which would turn mineral sands into products like zirconium and titanium. And the pre-feasibility study, which was conducted some years ago, told us that we get about $440 a ton for the export of mineral sands, all mineral sands, which we do at the moment. If we produce just one of the products, which is titanium alloy, it's not aircraft parts, titanium alloy, we get more than $100,000 a ton. There's several tons of sand into that, but that tells you there's value and there are jobs which are at the moment being realized in other economies. So we need to add more value to many of the mineral products before they leave our shores. There is value and there's jobs to be had from that. But the other side of it is that we need to create a new competitive advantage for manufacturing in South Africa, a new long-term competitive advantage. We used to sell South Africa as a destination for manufacturing based on cheap energy. You could come here and you could have the cheapest electricity in the world, but we can no longer offer that. The reasons I'm sure that you all understand, we can no longer offer that. So what is the long-term competitive advantage that we can create? And I think that it really is access to industrial minerals. And by access to industrial minerals, we don't mean you can buy it at the London Metal Exchange price or the import parity price, but we mean that it must be available in the form that is required for downstream manufacturing and also at a price which is competitive. And I know from engagements across the world, if we can score this, we can score many, many more industrial investments in this country. Now, what we're proposing in this IPAP is that we do a piece of work and identify five value chains, industrial mineral value chains. This will be very much linked to the work which the Department of Mineral Resources is doing on the amendments to the Mineral Petroleum Resources Development Act. What we need to do is to identify the opportunities as well as the regulatory requirements to realize those opportunities in particular value chains. Let me mention just as an example, platinum. The platinum price globally is, as everybody knows, is below what it was 6 to 8 months ago. If anybody thinks that we can return quickly to a commodity super cycle, I think we're betting on a horse that many people think is going to end up in the patty burgers that you're going to eat. So I think that's not a very small thing. What we need to do though is we need to use this resource that we have for a whole range of activities, from jewelry to catalytic converters and exhaust systems, and even to high-tech products like cell field manufacturing, including cell field manufacturing of small power generating plants. So we think that the first pillar that we need to build industrial development going forward is on realizing the benefits and opportunities that arise from the fact that we are a mineral producing country and an industrial mineral producing country through beneficiation. Secondly, we need to pursue regional integration. And I think that this is based on an analysis that we've done of the successes of many of our peer countries in the BRICS, for example, that many of them have identified the need for an important pillar of their growth process moving forward, in their domestic markets. Those countries, China and India in particular, but even Brazil, have got sizable domestic populations. put another way, they need some advice.